almost didn't get an episode together this week, kids. In fact, depending on what follows this unscripted preamble, we may still not get an episode this week. So if you're hearing me right now, I guess I came up with something to say, and you can hear it on the other side.
You're listening to the John Huff Podcast. Oh, yay.
I don't really have anything planned today, which is exceptionally unusual. I don't think I've ever come into an episode. Don't think I've ever sat down on my drum throne here in my little studio with less preparation than I'm bringing to you right now. And I was reluctant to do it. Okay, I don't want to waste your time. I don't want to waste my time. I feel an obligation to bring you content that is worth hearing, you know? Content that has some value in it. Content that has some, at least, entertainment in it. If nothing, you know, kind of life-changing. I do, you know, a superficial history, and that's hours and hours and hours of research and preparation. It may not seem like that. You might listen to my superficial histories and think I'm kind of off the cuffing it. I'm not. I am in the delivery, all right, but I'm not in the information. Like, I bring quite a lot of research to a superficial history. And I don't like coming into an episode cold because it feels like a disservice to you, the listener. And I just don't want to do that, man. And I don't want to do these kind of everybody sit down and listen to me talk for a while episodes. You know what I mean? And if you've been listening since the COVID started in particular, I've really been wrestling with this notion of how to exist online. And I'm still wrestling with that. You know, for a while, I shut down the show. Like, I took a hiatus from the show. I've done a few hiatuses from the show for various reasons. The last one, because I was on tour in Europe, all right? That is unavoidable. That's a cost of doing what I do, you know? The previous hiatus was a legit, I need to step away from this kind of hiatus. As part of that hiatus, I kind of stepped away from online life. So I separated from social media, which, you know, Facebook I was finding toxic, Instagram I was finding such a relentless and remorseless time suck, you know? Like, I would just find myself mindlessly scrolling. I know I've talked about this, and if you've been following along, you've heard what I've got to say about that. And then I realized over the past week or so that it's not even necessarily a social media addiction problem. It's probably a phone addiction more generally. It's very tactile, right? Like, you hear about a lot of people who smoke for a long time and they decide they're going to quit smoking. And what they miss, apart from the nicotine, is the habit of smoking. It's tactile. They miss the feeling of the cigarette in their fingers or the cigarette in their lips or whatever. And the phone is that. You know, the apps themselves are addictive, but they create or they contribute to a wider tactile phone addiction. So it's like you're always reaching for your dang phone anytime there's an opportunity to do so. I mean, some people are just blatant. You know, you sit down for lunch or whatever, or dinner with some folks, and they just got the dang phone in their hand scrolling through it, and they don't care or notice maybe that it's extraordinarily rude and dismissive to do so. I've done this before in the past, you know, and this is not me calling anybody out. I'm just observing that the addiction to actually holding the phone, touching the phone, looking at the phone becomes as powerful as the addiction to the apps, you know? And it drives me crazy when people at my table are more interested in whatever crap whatever pointless, useless BS is on their phone than they are in having a conversation with me, engaging in whatever's going on in the real world right in front of their faces, man. And of course, we all know about the people walking down the street banging into telephone poles because they got their faces in their phone. And the people who are wrapping their cars around telephone poles and other people because they got their face in their phone too. And it's a freaking problem, man. I began to recognize my addiction to this. I talked many, many episodes back about reading a book one night before bed and reaching down and trying to expand a black and white photo with my fingers in a physical book. It was at that point in time that I began to realize maybe we've got a problem, you know? So, as part of my hiatus from the pod, I took a hiatus from online life. I tried to disengage. Now, I was having some mood problems at the time, I think. You know, I wasn't super happy. I was feeling a lot of anxiety, a little bit stressed, not super fired up, you know, feeling as though, I don't know, I just probably wasn't super happy. I don't have the circumstances to call to mind right now. But, you know, I took a break for like a month. I just didn't engage with social media, man. And I felt better. Now, there's nothing on Instagram that's toxic to me in particular. You can curate your feed pretty effectively on Instagram, right? But it was just the simple, repetitive stimulation, man. Like, I would pick up the phone and for no reason, just because I had a minute, you know? There'd be a commercial on the TV show. I'd pick up the phone, check my Instagram. For what? For what? For nothing. I couldn't get through half of a soccer match. You know, I'd sit down to watch Arsenal, and I would have to, like, okay, dude, you cannot pick up that freaking phone until halftime, all right? Can you be an adult human being and resist that temptation for 45 freaking minutes? Are you in, you know, are you a child? Are you in grade 4 fidgeting in your freaking seat? You know, it's like you don't even think about it anymore. It's just your immediate impulse. At any, you know, moment where there's a hint of boredom, any moment where there's not enough stimulation, it's become habit now. It's, you don't even think about it. You just pick up the phone. You're at a restaurant with somebody, he or she gets up and goes to the bathroom. What do? Well, you don't look around. You know, you don't engage your circumstances. You don't try to live in the real world, maybe make a memory. You pick up the phone and you go to Instagram or you go to Facebook or you go to Twitter and you look for nothing. But we know the apps reward the behavior. I read a thing that said this notion of pulling down on the screen with your index finger that mimics the handle on a slot machine. I mean, social media companies have people working who mimic, who they go to casinos and they look at, how do we engage people? How do we give them dopamine hits? How do we keep them here spending their money? This is the modus operandi of casinos. Do whatever it takes to keep them here. Social media companies work exactly the same way. Do whatever it takes to keep them here. Your attention is currency, man. And so they give you the bells and whistles, they give you the notifications, they give you the things, and then it becomes a tactile dependency, just like smoking is, man. I don't like the cigarettes, but I like holding the cigarettes. You know, it all becomes part and parcel. It all becomes part of the compulsion, right? And I found that I was beginning to lose control of my conscious behavior. I was just picking up the phone, mindlessly scrolling through it, spending hours. Cumulative hours, right? You don't think about it at the time. It's 15 minutes or 20 minutes, whatever. Then you look at it at the end of the week and you spent X hours just scrolling through nothing on that app. And then I had to begin to look at, what am I posting? What do I think people out there need to hear from me? A selfie? You know, me in my bikini? Is that what they want to see? Do they want to see the hamburger that I'm eating for dinner? Why am I posting this stuff? What am I looking for here? Well, I'm looking for the dopamine hits, man. I want to be relevant. I want likes on my post. I'm not a 17-year-old girl. I'm an adult human man, and I would get upset if there wasn't enough attention on my posts, if there wasn't enough currency, man. So I'm losing control of my compulsions. I'm posting stuff that why do people think we need to see whatever BS you're doing in your day? Can you just do it and enjoy it and make a freaking memory? Like, why have we all become, you know, media companies? And I'm as guilty as anybody, all right? Not pointing the finger of blame, just asking the freaking question. And I have a theory that I have not seen this academically published, you know, but fame is the new currency, man. Fame is the dream. I've read about studies where they asked, you know, elementary school kids, even high school kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, the answer is famous, man. I just want to be famous because we've made fame the holy grail. Just want to be famous. And so social media platforms give you the opportunity to kind of be that, right? Very easy to get caught up in that. Very easy to get caught up in who's paying attention and how much attention are they paying and what can I do with that? And what does it say about me? I've been caught up in that. You know, it's an addictive thing. It's very, you know, it pulls you in like any other drug, man. Then you need more of the hit, more of the hit, more of the hit. You begin to lose more and more and more of yourself, and then you live more and more and more in this artificial online reality. And so when I had the troubles, you know, summer of 2020, the message, you know, the big overriding intuitive spiritual message was get small, dude. Stop being so public. Get existentially small, man. It was the message of what I needed to do to begin to recover from whatever was causing the anxiety in my life at that point in time. And so I did that. I took a break from the podcast. I took a break from social media, all right? And I felt better. I cannot quantify that. I can't point to the reasons why. Probably it was because it freed up my brain from this compulsion to be scrolling all the time. That's exhausting, man, and you cannot focus anymore. My attention span has dropped so dramatically in the past 6, 7, 8 years because you focus on something for 2 seconds and it's gone, 2 seconds and it's gone, 2 seconds and it's gone. Endless, relentless stimulation. I signed up to TikTok. I signed up to TikTok earlier in the fall, maybe late summer, because I applied for a gig somewhere. I should be careful about using that word, this being a music podcast. I signed up for a job somewhere. I applied to a job. My professional background is in public relations, corporate communications. All right, that's kind of what I did professionally before I began to pursue music. And so I still occasionally apply for jobs in the biz because, you know, especially right now, music can be a pretty dicey proposition, man. And my boy needs peace of mind. So I applied for a gig, and all of the comms gigs these days want you to be a social media manager, man. They want you to get their organization on TikTok. Whether your organization belongs there or not, gotta get on the TikTok, man, because that's where all the cool people are. I don't know anything about TikTok. Frankly, I don't want to know anything about TikTok, all right? I'm a 48-year-old man. But I signed up for the TikTok because I thought, if I'm going to get one of these gigs, I gotta learn what this is about, right? I lasted about 14 seconds on TikTok, and it was just an overwhelming visual display. Just videos, 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 videos. It was nuts, man. I couldn't deal with it. I had to put the freaking phone down. It is the antidote. For people of a certain age and temperament, TikTok might be the antidote to the cell phone addiction. Because you pick that up and your brain just goes like a popcorn bopper. You know what I mean? It just starts spilling out your ears. Relentless barrage of information stimulation, and your attention shifts, 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 shifts. Can't focus on anything, man. I have found this so much over the past 5, 6, 7, 8 years since I've really begun to engage with social media. I just had Facebook. I've had various Twitter accounts. Never really got into Twitter. Never really super duper worked for me, so I was never really too engaged there. I was on Facebook, whatever. And then I got into Instagram like 2015, something like that. And in that time, my attention span has reduced so dramatically. I noticed this, man. And I've also noticed a stunning drop to a certain extent in creative output. Specifically, I mean writing. And I'm beginning to wonder now if, you know, me not writing fiction anymore begins to correlate in some way with my, you know, increased use of social media. Like, writing a novel takes a certain amount of patience, time, and discipline. What does social media not work with? Patience, time, and discipline, man. It's like image, 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 video, 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 new thing, new thing, new thing, scroll, 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 look for likes, 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 hits, hits, hits. Dopamine, 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 man. It's anti-social media. I found myself all caught up in that, but then when I withdrew for like a month, felt better. And I think it has to do with my brain just running at lower RPMs, man. It's agitating. It is anxiety causing, looking for the next thing, looking for the next thing. It's like being at a casino and hitting that button, man. See what comes up. See what comes up. Oh, it's a jackpot. It's a picture I like or something like that. It causes anxiety, anticipating the next thing. Just always anticipating, anticipating, anticipating. Never being in the moment, just anticipating the next moment. I think it does bad things to your brain, man. And I think it's done bad things to mine. So I got away from the social media and began to feel better. Okay, so here's the deal. We goes away to Europe. Okay, Sarah Smith tour. And I did not post much by my standards about that tour. Not one single thing on Facebook, nothing. And I did, you know, like maybe 15 posts on Instagram over the course of a 6-week tour, all right? And there was stuff in there that would have been worth posting about, you know, by the standards of the platform. I was seeing and doing some interesting things, right? I didn't post a lot. I didn't want to be super public. I wanted to enjoy the experience. I didn't want to be having a coffee in the town square in a medieval German town so that I could take a photo of the coffee in the medieval German square and post it on Instagram. I wanted to just be there, make a memory, you know what I mean? Feel the air, have the experience. If you are doing things as a way or with the intention of putting them on social media, you're just not there, man. Even if you are there, you're thinking about the photo you want to take, the video you want to take. You're always thinking about some future online thing. You're not in the moment. I wanted to be in the moment, all right? But what I began to allow myself to do just a little bit was re-engage with social media while I was there. Had a lot of van hours. You know, there were people who were posting stuff on Facebook with videos of shows or pictures or whatever. Those things are interesting to look at from both a practical and a personal point of view. Practical because you can watch a video of yourself playing and you can go, oh man, I don't sound good, or I missed that part, or I rushed that, or whatever. Or conversely, you can look and say, wow, my technique is way better than I thought. There is practical, useful stuff in here if you go and look at those videos with the goal of learning, right? I didn't look at a lot. There are way more videos and photos than I saw because I don't like Facebook anymore. So I wasn't engaging a lot, but I was engaging some, right? Engaging some. And I began to just dip into Instagram a little bit more than I had been. And the funny thing is, and I just picked it up, you know, last week, is that it took seconds for me to just begin the mindless scrolling again. And all of a sudden, the whole freaking thing just starts up again. Every time I get 2 seconds, I'm picking up my phone. I'm scrolling through Instagram. I took the Facebook app off my phone, by the way. Instagram, I left on, but I log out of it every time. Thinking, well, you know, that's an extra layer of pain in the ass to try to get to it. But it doesn't matter because I find myself taking the extra step anyways. Found myself re-engaging with Instagram, and that almost immediately turns into just mindless scrolling. Going to the search page and just seeing what random stuff is there that's recommended to me by the all-knowing, all-seeing algorithm. Very, very soon, the addiction is back. Very, very soon, my every impulse at any second of downtime is to pick up the phone. Tactile, again, this addiction to the feeling of the phone, the scrolling with the phone. My thumbs do it automatically. My hands do it automatically. And you might say that's okay, and maybe for a lot of people it is. But the amount of hours that just get sucked down the Insta hole, you know? Or the Twitter hole, or the Facebook hole. And not just that. Immediately I begin to notice my attention span shortening again. I begin to notice this anxiety ramping up again. At a certain point, I was like, where is this anxiety coming from? Why do I feel so on edge? Why do I just feel not great? And it's gotta be because of that. That is the factor that came back into the situation, man. Scrolling, scrolling, scrolling. Dopamine, dopamine, dopamine. The whole thing begins again, and you lose control of your mind. Your impulses, your compulses take over, man. And they begin to run you. And when you lose your attention span, not to mention all that time, whatever creative thing you're going to do, you begin to lose the ability to do that because you can't sit down and work on a new song or even play the drums or practice or whatever because that impulse to pick up the phone or a notification flashes or whatever. Why is the notification flashing on your phone more important to you than the person sitting across the table from you? Why? What is on the phone that you think is so freaking good? This is maddening, but I've been guilty of it too. And you look around and you just see it everywhere. I mean, they make memes about phone zombies. But it's most of us, man. But it's not just the time and the attention suck. What is it doing to your attention span? What is it doing to your creative potential? What is it sucking out of you energy-wise? I began to notice this, man. I began to notice last week that I just did not feel good. And the changing factor in the equation was that I was allowing myself to indulge the Instagram again. And even a little bit the Facebook. And it's like, oh yeah, I'm losing control. I feel unsettled because I am not in control of my behavior right now. The device is. The apps are. And I had to readjust and I had to sit down and think about that. And then that brings up all the questions again. Do I do a podcast? Why am I posting what I'm posting on Instagram? What have I been posting? Is this just, you know, for superficial likes? Is this just to pump my ego? And then you sit down at the microphone like I did, you know, 20 minutes ago with nothing prepared. And it's like, should I say anything? Am I delivering anything of substance or value here? Or am I just talking to hear myself talk? And isn't that a symptom of the whole situation? Isn't that the same as posting a picture of my French fries because I think the world needs to see them? And I don't want to do that, kids, all right? I find myself in this place right now where I just don't know how public I want to be because I don't know why I want to be it. And that's a hard, hard thing to sort out. And you're probably sitting there right now thinking, dude, you're probably overthinking all of this. And you're right. And you're right. But I'm also trying to figure out my life, okay? I'm trying to figure out what I want to do. And why am I even talking about this? What's it got to do with anything? Except maybe you're in the same boat. I don't know about that. So I'm trying to navigate my way to still having a social media presence because, to a certain extent, the podcast kind of depends on it, but I'm not 100% sure about that anymore either. You know, I spend a lot of time and quite a lot of effort advertising the podcast on the gram and on the Facebook. Now, the Facebook, I don't spend a lot of time there anymore, so what appears there is generally reposted from Instagram to my Facebook podcast page. I post almost nothing on my personal page anymore, and I will be posting less. But I spent time on Instagram posting about new podcast episodes, and you kind of need that. But I'm beginning to wonder, actually, if you do. Like, do you need that? Instagram, Twitter, I'm done with Twitter. Do you need that to publicize your podcast? And then you step another layer back and you go, well, do you need a podcast? So what I hope I'm giving you with these episodes, the superficial histories, whatever, is something of some value. Because otherwise, I'm just talking to hear myself talk, and that's not okay, man. This ego thing is destroying a lot of people. It's destroying a lot of society. I can't quantify that either, except to say people want so much attention. People want so much ego gratification, and I'm more guilty than most of that. I've had to admit that to myself since I started with the troubles last year. You know, I have attachments to things that are ego-based. You know, always looking to be, have my tires pumped, you know what I mean? And so much of what gets posted on social media is about that. It's not offering value, it's offering an opportunity for people to pump your tires. That is not healthy behavior. It's ubiquitous, it's what we do now without even thinking about it, and I'm the same, at least until recently. And I don't want to get caught up in that. And all that to say, I'm reluctant to do this episode right now, because what am I doing except talking about myself? And I don't know if that's helpful or not. You know, I really don't. And I may not even publish this. I'm going to get it out of my system. But I don't know if I'm going to publish it, because I don't know if it offers you anything. And if it doesn't, there's no point doing it. Other than to hear myself talk, and, you know, I have it recorded, so I can just do the playback and listen, you know what I mean? So I don't know what to do. Public-wise, you know, being a public person, I'm really feeling the impulse to shut down social media altogether and just withdraw. Just withdraw again and get small again. I don't know what that means for the podcast. Maybe there's a way to do that in such a way that I don't have to spend much time in the online world. I can just do the show if it's doing something for you and me, and sort of be separate from all the other stuff. And that's something I need to negotiate and navigate, all right? But I'm telling you, if you're feeling anxiety, if you're feeling agitation, if you're feeling like you can't focus on anything, you can't concentrate on anything, if you're feeling just a general dis-ease, take a look at your social media consumption. Take a look at how often your phone is in your hand. Take a look at what you're posting and why. Take a look at what you're consuming and why. Man, you are what you eat. That's not just food. That is also information. If you're taking in junk, pointless, empty information, the output is junk, empty, pointless output. And it's agitating. Waiting and anticipating the next thing that comes up. This is serious business, man. It's affecting our brains. And I fear for the kids. I fear for the two-year-olds whose parent is an iPad. You know, it's like, this can't be good, man. This can't be good. And then the teenagers and all the added pressure that comes with, you know, a lack of media literacy or a lack of media savvy. The 14-year-old girl who sees, you know, this 100% manipulated photo of some beautiful person online, holds that up as a kind of ideal beauty standard that she can never meet. Guess what? The model doesn't meet it either, man. Filters, photo manipulation, angles, makeup, all that stuff. You know, it's a pressure-filled world. Even for an adult with a certain amount of media literacy, it's easy to get wrapped up in this crap. What's it like for a kid? I just don't need to be in that space anymore, man. It does something to you. So I don't have anything prepared, but I'm thinking a lot about whether I should be saying anything at all. You know what I mean? But I want it to be positive. If I am talking, I want you to at least come away with an uplifting kind of message or something useful. And the useful tidbit today is, if you're feeling all those things, no attention span, no creativity, can't focus, can't get things done, feeling agitated, feeling frustrated, feeling anxious, check your phone activity, man. Check your social media. You are ramping yourself up. And the whole shebang is designed to be addictive and pull you in and keep you there. I stepped my foot back in for a couple of weeks and I'm beginning to feel myself melting down already. Step away from it. See what happens. See if you can. And if you can't do it, if you say to yourself, I'm not going to check social media for 1 week, and you can't do it, you got yourself an addiction, my friend, and that ain't okay. No, addiction is good. Even addiction to exercise will break your body in the end, man. Moderation is everything. I don't know if I can be moderate. Maybe I can. I hope I can. Hope I can find a way. And let me know if what I did for the last half hour has any value to you whatsoever. Because if it didn't, I probably shouldn't do it anymore, you know? Now, one of the things you can do, uplift your mood, is listen to some music, man. And I would, again, be derelict in my officiousness if I did not give you some music to check out. I'm going to point you to the new solo record by the great Jerry Cantrell, okay? Jerry Cantrell of Alice in Chains, of course, recently released a brand new solo record called Brighton, and I tried it on a whim. Every now and again, I check the new releases, and then I see if there's anything that seems compelling to me, and then I go check it out. Well, that was the case with Jerry, and really like this record, man. And you know what? You can believe me when I say that. Because I don't like a lot of records. I listen to a lot of new stuff that I don't talk about on this show because I don't really dig it. So if I'm talking about it, chances are good that I really like it, man. And I like Jerry Cantrell's record. Now, I've always been an Alice in Chains guy. Alice in Chains occupies this bizarre space, kind of between glam metal and grunge. You know, glam metal people, a lot of them did not embrace the grunge scene, particularly Nirvana, okay? Over time, some of them softened. I never really super-duper got into it, but I'm not hostile anymore. But most of the glam scene dug on Alice in Chains for whatever reason. I'm not 100% sure why that is. Maybe because, you know, however you want to pigeonhole them, terrific freaking band. And their first few albums were dynamite stuff, man. And Layne Staley, is it fair to say Layne Staley was underrated as a singer? What a unique and compelling and powerful voice that dude had. That guy was freaking dynamite, okay? Unapologetic in his choice of lifestyle, drugs, 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 and paid the ultimate price for it, and I think he was okay with that. But what you don't really realize until you listen to a Jerry Cantrell solo record is just how much his voice contributes to that signature Alice in Chains sound, man. And what you get on this record is a lot of tunes that sound like Alice in Chains. Now I'm going to do my service to you is to offer you three songs you ought to check out, all right? They are the first two songs, which are Atone and Brighton, and a song called Siren Song, which I think is really terrific. But you listen to those first two, Atone and Brighton, and dude, Alice in Chains. They are Alice in Chains songs. They have that. Some of the music theory people out there who can explain to me how harmonies work. I can sing harmonies. That's part of what I do, but I can't necessarily explain what they are. There is a certain almost atonal harmony that is a feature of Alice in Chains songs that I don't really hear anyplace else. It's a way of harmonizing that they do, which I'm realizing is Jerry Cantrell. It's the way he hears vocal harmonies. And they're all over those first two songs. And that makes them sound like Alice in Chains tunes, even without Layne Staley, right? And Atone is the first song on the record. It's heavy. It's dark. That's the other, of course, signature of Alice in Chains, is how dark those freaking songs were, man. There's a lot of darkness coming through on Jerry Cantrell's record, although, you know, it is called Brighton. And towards the end of the record, it actually does that just a little bit. You get some more major chords, you know, more sing-along kind of stuff. Still rock and roll, though, man. Still got that, just that veneer of darkness, which is Alice in Chains. And then Brighton is the title track. Just a good song, man. Just a banger. And this dude is good, man. Jerry Cantrell himself may be underrated. Underrated as a singer, underrated as a guitar player. I saw a video on YouTube one time, and it was, I love this sort of thing. And it's where they bring in people, like big time stars, and they got their guitar and they're sitting on a stool, and then they just play some of the stuff. You know, there's a couple of great ones with Ty Tabor from King's X, where he's just playing the songs on his guitar. Like, this is what it is. This is what it goes to. This is how it works. I find that fascinating. I find that mesmerizing to watch because I'm mesmerized by guitar players and I wish I was a better one, you know? So there's a video I watched of Jerry Cantrell doing that. He's just sitting down. He's got that tone. Terrific tone, Jerry Cantrell. Influenced, I would imagine, by Ty Tabor, because we know Alice in Chains were big King's X fans. Alice in Chains opened for King's X a bunch back in the early days, so there's, you know, some crossover there. And Jerry Cantrell's got this great tone, and he's just playing through some of the riffs, and it's like, yeah, man, that dude is tasty. These are great songs, great guitar-based rock and roll tunes, man. And Alice in Chains had a signature kind of tone, a signature kind of sound, and a very unique, distinctly Alice in Chains vibe, man. It comes through on Brighton, the record, and the song. It comes through on a tone, and then you get the song Siren Song, which is cool because it starts out as basically the Unforgiven, Metallica, right? It starts as that, and then it morphs into Down in a Hole by Alice in Chains, man. And those are two pretty dark dang songs. Jerry Cantrell delivers, you know, that song, Siren Song, is really, really cool. I'll probably put that on the John Huff podcast, referenced on the podcast playlist, where you can get all the tunes, or at least most of them that we've talked about so far this year on the show. Put that one on there. So if you're looking for something new to listen to, it's something a little bit dark, a little bit heavy, very, very cool record. Jerry Cantrell's Brighton. Listened to it on a whim, found that I liked it. Okay, now if you're more into the visual stuff, you gotta go online onto the YouTube, and you've got to look at the War on Drugs, their 4-song set on World Cafe, all right? I know I never shut up about the War on Drugs, okay? And I know some of you aren't super into that band. Now, I know a lot of you super are, as you should be. Some of you, not really working for you, and that's okay, all right? Not everything is for everyone. They are an art rock band, all right? They are an alt rock band. If your thing is hard rock, heavy metal, maybe you're not into the world, to the War on Drugs, okay? That's okay. That's all right, man. We're all individuals. We're all snowflakes, okay? They had recently done Tiny Desk. It was like the first time that they popped up and played new songs from the new record, right? So they popped up on Tiny Desk, and the first song they played was the title track, I Don't Live Here Anymore, from the new record. Now, I'm going to tell you again, I love that freaking song. It's probably my song of the year, all right? When I was in Europe, I had it on repeat on my headphones. Probably listened to it 200 freaking times. A wonderful song, and I love it, all right? I'm still listening to it. They popped up on NPR, and it was like their first performance of some of the new tunes, and the first one on the list was I Don't Live Here Anymore, so I, you know, wrap my hands together, because there's a wonderful keyboard part that drives this whole song, all right? It's a rock song, bass, guitar, and drums, but there's keyboards running through it that make it. Kind of a Boys of Summer vibe, almost, you know? And this keyboard part drives the whole freaking thing. Really, really cool. And so they step up to play I Don't Live Here Anymore, and it's like an acoustic version without that keyboard part, and for me, fell flat. Some people thought, wow, we love that version better. I think that's what Adam Granduciel had in mind when he wrote the tune. I listened to the whatever it was. I listened to a songwriting podcast where Adam from the War on Drugs was the guest, and they talked about this song. He said, originally, I had written this acoustic thing, and then I sent it off to my keyboard player, because he was asking if I was working on anything that I could hear, and I sent it off to him, and then he sent it back to me, said, I tried a thing, and it might be crap, I don't know, give it a listen. And what he tried was the keyboard line that makes and utterly changed the entire song. It's beautiful, and I can't stop listening to it, right? So I love that. I love that that's where it came from, you know, but it was missing from this performance. The rest of the performance of the tunes on the Tiny Desk was terrific. Very disappointed in that song. So fast forward a couple weeks, I'm listening to something on YouTube. I'm elsewhere in the house. And next in queue, unbeknownst to me, is the War on Drugs, their performance on World Cafe. So I'm just doing my thing. All of a sudden, I hear the song. I Don't Live Here Anymore. It's like, oh, yeah, cool. It fast-forwarded or it defaulted, you know, the next thing up is the record. Cool. Then I'm like, wait a minute. this is live. And my ears perk up. It's like, whoa, they're playing it live. And they're playing it for real, man. And so I go running to my computer to see what's happening. And it turns out to be this World Cafe performance where they played the song properly and they had backup singers going. And then I'm just mesmerized, right? It's freaking beautiful. And then they did, you know, three more songs. They did Change. They did, I think, Old Skin. And I Don't Want to Wait. And dude, if you haven't gone and listened to this record, fine. Go listen to I Don't Want to Wait, because that song is creeping up on Song of the Year for me, all right? And the performance of all these songs is freaking dynamite. So restorative and so exciting, because I got my tickets to see them in February, kids, all right? And if you're into the War on Drugs, you must go check this out. War on Drugs, World Cafe, four songs, all right? This is such a good band. This is such a good live band. Such great players. You know, such great songs. And if you're not into them, I can't make you into them. Not for you, that's fine. They are for me, man. And this performance on World Cafe is one of the greatest things I've seen on YouTube in a long, long dang time. And I've watched it over and over and over and over. And I've sent it to people. Like, you've got to watch this. This band is so good. These songs are so good. I Don't Want to Wait is the last song. You know, if you must, if you really don't want to give them that much of a chance, listen to the first song, I Don't Live Here Anymore, performed properly, and the last song, I Don't Want to Wait. And dude, this is a band working at the highest level, and this record should be huge. As much as any record can be huge anymore, it should be. I hope it is, and I'm pumping it to everybody, okay? So I hope you appreciated, or at least were somewhat entertained, interested in my social media rant. Do check out Jerry Cantrell's record. Do check out that performance by the War on Drugs. Really, really super duper stuff. I don't know what to do, because their tour's going to start soon, if it hasn't already, and there's going to be a lot of footage online. It's like, do you watch the footage before you go and see them, or do you kind of avoid the footage? So that when you see them, it's fresh, you know? I don't know what to say about that. I have to think it over. But I'm spending less time online, so, you know, maybe I won't see it after all. In any case, I'm gonna go, all right? I know this was a weird episode. Some people might like the weird episodes. Sometimes the off-the-cuff episodes wind up being the best ones. Maybe you like that better than a superficial history. I don't know. Drop me a line and let me know, okay? You can still, like, my Facebook Messenger app is up. You can message me on Facebook. I will continue to check in on Instagram, you know, briefly, probably every day or every couple days. I'll probably still post ads there for the episodes, so you can comment on them. You can send me a little message. You can message me via my website, john-huff.com/contact. And, you know, let me know if you like this format of an episode. Let me know if you like me off the cuff in it. Let me know if you like me doing more thought out and prepared superficial histories. You know, just drop me a line and say hi. Would be nice to know you're listening. You know what I mean? And I will implore you again to drop me a rating and review wherever you listen to fine podcasts. Okay, dude, it helps. It definitely helps and it warms my cockles. Okay, gonna shut up, shutting up. Hope you're having a good week. And, you know, good things happen when you put yourself out there, kids. Do not lose sight of that message, okay? If I never speak to you again, take away good things happen when you put yourself out there, because they do, all right? So do your thing, man. Do your thing. Do it unapologetically, as long as it doesn't hurt anyone. Do it to the best of your abilities. Do it for the right reasons and watch the doors open, okay? Speaking of which, I'm going to open and then close the door and get myself on out of here. So I'll check ya later. Yeah.
I'm the man in the box.